Good morning. So are we all awake? Good, good. So when Michelle approached me and said, can you come and talk? And I fully she said yes. She didn't give me a subject, so I had to make up my own topic. And I thought, what should I talk about? Because I did talk a couple of years ago, and I gave a talk about glimpses of the future of technology, and we started to explore how technology is changing people's lives. And over the last 5 years, I've been exploring this question of how do we understand the value of the data economy, the digital economy? How do we start to understand whether data is actually valuable or not? And so I thought I'd have the question, is my data valuable? And that's where I thought I'd spend a bit of time thinking through this. I've never given this presentation before, so maybe over the last few days. So you have to give me some feedback when you think about it. Can you hear me without this? I guess you need this for the recording. Okay, so let's start by understanding how does data become valuable. Okay, data on its own is just a pile of data. In itself, doesn't actually create any value. So how does it become valuable? Well, it becomes valuable because we do something with it. And we use technology in the form of algorithms and computers to analyze that data. And that data then turns into information. Right? And that information alone is not valuable. But it's what that information does that becomes valuable. Okay. Does that make sense? Nods? Yeah. Pretty simple, right? So how do I bring that to life? Well, let's look at Wimbledon. Everybody watch Wimbledon? Yeah. So we go to Wimbledon and we get tons of data. We put things like these cameras out there, Hawkeyes, and those cameras then capture data. And that data is analyzed through a rack of computers that sit underneath the courts at Wimbledon. And outcomes information, and we know things like, was the ball in or not? What was the speed of the serve? That information is of some value to any spectator watching that. Whether the ball's in or not is kind of pretty important for the players. You know, that's really good, valuable information. But that in itself isn't value per se. That's just information. Okay, and as you saw that in your minds, something happened. You started to remember Wimbledon games that you went to. You started to remember all kinds of things about Wimbledon that you related with. And what was happening in your mind was remembering, you know, Federer or whoever it was that you remember. And it's that invocation, it's that reminding you of what was there, that experience that you had, that really creates the inspiration for you to do something. Do I go and apply for the tickets for Wimbledon for next year? Do I want to go and play tennis, right? Well, all of these start to get triggers for you to do things. So information is a way of triggering in the mind some kind of action. And it's that action that can result in the value. So, is information on its own valuable is still a very important question. So if I just give you a pile of information and I give you a document, is that of value to you? Okay. Now, when we start looking at information and somebody says, this is top secret information, that is of potential value. And we know some of the wrong end of that information, so when we look at Enron and some of the insider dealing, that creates a very different set of views and impressions of information. That's all just information. Whether it's written documents, whether it's data, it's still just information. But it's what you do with the data that really gets the value. So the first thing that you realize is there is a gap between information and value, which isn't really understood. The information that you have in front of you, but something that happens that information before it becomes valuable. And how do we start to understand that journey from information to value? So we understand this equation. This equation is part of the data science, Computing Science Institute has been for many, many years. But there's a new equation that's emerging that we haven't really uncovered very much of. And that equation is saying information in context creates insight. The serve for Wimbledon at Wimbledon tells us something about an individual server. And it's that context which gives you some new insight. It's the bringing together of the information into a context that really starts to create the value. Again, that insight isn't enough. You're knowing that there is the opportunity for transforming a system is valuable, but until somebody does something about it, nothing happens. Insight is a thing that has to drive action. And it's the action that a person takes that creates the outlook. So I want you to start thinking through that bit and say, okay, so how do we relate to that? How does that outcome create real value? And there are really a range of different outcomes that emerge. The first outcome is simply optimization. Okay? So I can optimize the system. How long does it take for me to get from here to my home? Can I accurately say how long it's going to take? I probably can't. Okay.
So as I start to move from one level of system to another level of system, I can create a level of optimization. I can find where the inefficiencies are in the system, and I can optimize that system. By optimizing the system, I can create potential value using the cost of that system. The second piece is I can eliminate things. There are things that we do because we have been told we have to do them, because we do them for lots of good reasons. Those things aren't necessary in the bottom page. I fill in a form. Do I need to fill in that form? No, I can do it online. I can remove pieces of the jigsaw. And then the last part is improvement. Simple improvement. So the fact that I have a wearable watch means that I probably do a bit more exercise and I start to improve my life. By giving me insight into where I'm being less efficient, I'm eating the right amount of food, or I'm going to start that stuff. It's enough. So those are the three primary outcomes. You can either get some optimization, you can get some elimination of something. We can get some elimination of things, or we can ultimately get some kind of improvement. And that improvement is the ultimate value. It's what you perceive as value, and then you contribute that to that value. That could be at the individual level, it could be at the corporation level, it could be at the council level, it could be at a place of work. Does that make any sense? It's just another bad man talking about it. So let's try and bring this to life a little bit. Let's look at a couple of examples.
Thousand train cars, 32,500 miles of track, 2,000 sensors detecting changes in temperature, vibration, alignment, all factors that could cause a derailment. But one cause can be especially hard to spot, a single cracked wheel. And out of more than 1.5 million wheels, how do you find the right one? By listening. You can't hear it, but analytics can. Working with IBM, a railroad analyzes 100,000 data points a day to help stop trouble before it starts.
So that's an example of picking a problem which really matters. In the US, derailment is a massive, massive issue. And one of the primary causes of derailment is actually cracked wheel. We don't know when a cracked wheel happens. Nobody goes and inspects every wheel. We have an inspection cycle where actually every year somebody goes along with a hammer and hammers each wheel. And that's a process by which we found out whether that wheel was cracked or not. But as soon as the wheel is slightly cracked, there is a risk that the train could derail. Now, the wheel, as it goes on the track, when it's cracked, the sound signature changes very, very slightly, but it does change. And by putting a microphone underneath each one of the wheels, you can hear the sound. You can hear that signature, and using analytics, we can start to pick out where that signature is going to take place. And then we can pick out this wheel here as potentially cracked. Now that's an example of taking the context, taking analytics, and taking the information that we get the data from the sensors. And so the point here is, anything that you can capture data from, you can start to change things. You can actually have huge amounts of learning. So, so then you ask a question, okay, so how much, how big is this pie that we can go after? If we think there's value in this, how much value is there? A couple of years ago, some of my colleagues in the US worked with a set of economists, and they started to look at where are the efficiencies in systems around the world. And the answer was this. So if you look at various systems, no matter which system you look at, the total is about $4 trillion of waste that can be removed from systems. So the opportunity for applying data in the real value sense into systems is about $4 trillion. And if you want to read the report, if you just search $4 trillion in IBM, you'll find the report and so forth. You can find out where your issues are. And a lot of it, not surprisingly, is in healthcare. A big chunk of the value is actually healthcare. But another chunk of the value is in crime. So how can data help us with crime? Any thoughts or suggestions? Do you think data can help with crime? No. Let's look at another quick picture.
I used to think my job was all about arrests, chasing bad guys. Now I see them work differently. We analyze crime data, spot patterns, and figure out where to send patrols. It's helped some U.S. cities cut serious crime by up to 30%. They're stopping it before it happens. Let's build a smarter planet.
So that's a bit of a joke video, but the reality is it's not far away. Often, when people are about to do a crime, they use social media to discuss elements of a crime. And it's not too hard to use analytics to be able to pick up those sound signatures of their tweets, their phone calls, and be able to use that as a way of predicting where crimes will take place. And rather than letting the crime happen, we just happen to get the listening. We did that in the past by having large numbers of bodies on the beat, and by having bodies in the right place, crime will be reduced. We can't afford the same number of police staff anymore, so we have to get much smarter. We've got to try and figure out where the crime's going to happen and position them. And if you think that's just a pipe dream, go look at a case study in New York. Over a 4-year period, they drove down crime by 50% by doing exactly this. And often it's not the data that any one police authority has, it's data across the authorities. So when the officer approaches a potential criminal, by being able to understand the full context of that individual's crimes, you're able to take a much more reasoned judgment rather than the silent piece of information. So often the value sits in the combination of these things, and it's being able to find that combination of these things. So let's go to a very different example. Ball bearings. My favorite topic, ball bearings. So the ball bearing industry, how many of you know the ball bearing industry? Okay. So the ball bearing industry, when I started getting involved in it 3.5 years ago, I didn't realize that the industry lost 5 billion euros a year in Europe because of counterfeit ball bearings. Counterfeit bearings, which are made in places like India and China, which look exactly like the original equipment, but a lower grade steel, which lasts a matter of months rather than a matter of years, are sold into the system as being original equipment price. Purchaser puts it on their motorbike, on their car, on their machinery, but it doesn't last. And when it fails, the person who gets the phone call is not the counterfeiter, but the actual. So not only do they miss out on the sale of the spare part, they have to carry the cost of replacement. Massive, massive issue. So can we do anything to address this topic? Because this is, again, another opportunity for value. And here, there's a range of things that we can start to do. So we looked at, for example, using the ball bearing as a sensor. So if we start to embed intelligence into that sensor, then how can that sensor not only become unique and tell us it's unique, happen, and also be a way in which it creates new value. So the notion is not all there. Just have a look at a quick video on this.
The supply chain is only as strong as its weakest link. Last year, dishonest suppliers passed off $600 billion worth of counterfeit materials. Today, smarter enterprises are virtually eliminating fraud by using big data and analytics to verify every component in a finished product. So the only thing they sell is the genuine article.
So in that example, what you didn't realize was we were just scanning barcodes, but actually it wasn't just a barcode. Every single unit in the box has an RFID. So for example, if you get any one of the mobile phones, the NFC chip or the RFID chip that sits inside those devices can be scanned. And through a simple scan of the unit, you can know everything about it. You know everything about where it's come from, what it's going to go to, where it's manufactured, got all that information. And all of a sudden, now if you've got some kind of devices coming through that network, it beats, say, it's that something real. And you can catch that much earlier in the supply chain. Make sense?
Can I just ask, is it high capital cost for or what's the payback period?
So if I look at, for example, ball bearings, the payback was 6 months. It's phenomenal. It's pretty quick. So, I mean, you won't realize just how many parts they get. When I went to go see the manufacturer, they put in front of us two boxes. And they said, one of these is counterfeit, one's real. You need to tell us which. And we were there for 30 minutes. They were absolutely perfect. You could not, they didn't weigh any different, they didn't feel any different, the packaging was identical. The only way we could figure it out was put some kind of RFID signature on there, which had a unique ID, which gave the manufacturer. Once we had that, we stopped the demand. The volumes were just unbelievable. They had underpredicted it. So even when they were underpredicted, we were getting a very good return. But this happens all as a surprising challenge. Health is a big, big topic. And you don't have to have big data. I've given you some high-end technology answers here. So whether it's using the sound signature on the wheel, or whether it's using RFIDs or complex sensors. But actually, in places like Tanzania, you don't need complex data. You can save lives with really simple pieces of data. Really, really simple systems can actually solve major problems and actually even save lives. So let's look at another example.
Today in Tanzania, it is estimated that 220 people die of malaria. The same amount died yesterday, and the same amount will die tomorrow.
If you have malaria, this is a treatable disease. You treat with medicines. If medicines are not there, you can die.
Unfortunately, stockouts of certain medicines at the health facility level in many sub-Saharan African countries have been an ongoing and persistent problem for many years. To combat stockouts, Novartis led the creation of a public-private partnership called SMS for Life, which brings weekly visibility to the stock levels of anti-malarials in local health facilities.
Well, the idea is that on a weekly basis, we would send out an SMS request message to all of the health facilities, requesting them to enter the current stock of anti-malarials. All the data is then collected in a central system, and all the data then becomes available via the internet or BlackBerry mobile phones for district medical officers or other users to see.
Partners including Novartis, the Rollback Malaria Partnership, Vodafone, IBM, and the Tanzanian Ministry of Health and Social Welfare implemented a 21-week pilot program in Tanzania that ended in February 2010. During the pilot, participating health facilities effectively managed their supply of life-saving anti-malarial treatments. At the start of the pilot, 26% of all health facilities had no ACTs of any dose type, but by the end of the pilot, the stockout rate had been reduced to just 0.8%, almost full availability.
This project is very happy that at the end, I think the malaria morbidity were reduced and also mortality will also be reduced.
The success in these Tanzanian districts during the pilot phase of the program demonstrates how working together and harnessing the core competencies of multiple public and private organizations creatively and effectively can make a positive impact and save the lives of malaria patients in Africa.
So that's a real example, and it really was saving 220 lives. And it's such a simple, not knowing where we needed malaria drugs was something that we saw just as simple as this. Just need somewhere to live. And often we don't spend enough time looking at the real problems that are just on our doorstep. And that's where the difference comes. If you care enough about something, the data's out there to fix those things. Whether it's your pothole, whether it's your propensity to live, whether it's your creating inspiration is going to make a difference. It's there. It's what you do with that data that makes a difference. The data is often there. So let's turn to something a bit more sinister then and say, okay, well, that's all great. That's solving things that matter. But what about other issues with data? Do you guys care about data privacy or all this kind of thing? How many of you are familiar with this example of Target? I hope most of you have seen this. Target, through analysis, could figure out when a teenager was pregnant and send them a kit at home before the parents knew that the child was pregnant. Is that an ethical use of the data? Is that an appropriate use of data? You can argue in lots of different ways. Commercial guys may argue this is reasonable, others more humanitarian might have a very different view. But data about you, everything that you're doing is public business. The fact that you have a mobile phone with you in the car or when you're traveling means that your telco, your mobile phone provider knows where you are. By being able to use that data, we can see the speed and trajectory of your phone, and by overlaying that on the context of a map, we'll know whether you're speeding or not. Now that data is actually aggregated and sold back to people. In fact, Vodafone aggregates that data and sells it to TomTom as high resolution traffic data. We buy that high resolution traffic data because it helps you decide whether to take a particular road or not. And then you get governments who realize that's quite a good way of deciding where to put speed cameras, as happened in Amsterdam. So the Amsterdam government, local government, decided to subpoena the data from Vodafone and decide where to place speed cameras. And the uproar was absolutely normal. Now, the question we might need to ask ourselves is, how long is it then before we have sufficient information about you in the car, how fast you're doing, and you automatically get a speed fine because your mobile phone knows how fast you're doing? Is that appropriate? Is that fair? Now, many of you will tweet, and I see some great tweets coming along here, and you may not realize just what your tweets are doing. So I took the tweets of an individual's here today and did a psychometric analysis. This is actually analysis of the individual. When I sent it back to the individual, it was surprising just how accurate it was. So I took a year and a half's worth of tweets, and the Twitter analysis, the linguistic analysis, the words that you use in your messaging, gives amazing clues about your personal values, what your needs are, how you think. That can be used not just to understand an individual, but to then tune messaging to that individual and tune it in a way which changes the behavior of that individual. That's what you're all doing. You
intuitively doing this. And it was really funny because I tweeted on Saturday that I'd done this and so on. And I had a professor from the US send me an email, DM saying, hey, this is really interesting, but isn't this just another mumbo jumbo of my Briggs? Don't believe it. There's no science behind it, it's just a bit of good marketing. And I said, no, it's not. You just go look at the analysis. We based it on quite a lot of deep linguistic analysis, this is the research. You've got to have a look. He spent the rest of Saturday analyzing the research. And on Sunday, he wrote a really lucid blog on how the psychometric analysis that we're doing is not just mumbo jumbo, it's actually based on a lot of science. And so all of a sudden, you know, he was a convert. He saw these analysis and said, wow, you know, this is somebody who has and by the way, you've got enough information from there to know how to motivate that individual to do so. And so what we're doing right now is saying, can we use this to adapt the ways in which we dialogue with individuals from retailing, from authors, and so on. And retailers love this concept, and we're absolutely not. So how long is it before somebody says, we can take this data and know, oh, it's actually going to want to be our sleepers next week, and we're going to get them to write that sleepers. So ultimately, it's realizing that it's not the data that matters, but every individual is special. Every individual is unique, and we have to start to look and think about every individual as a unique person. And it's being able to use those fragments of information, because data in the digital sense never gives you the full picture. It's actually bringing together the fragments of information that allow us to build a full picture and pull together the context. Because once we start to pull together that context, then we can start to make some things together.
There's a dimension of IBM which is always looking at, it's not everything we do, but it's a continuing important component of what we do to keep pushing the frontiers of analysis and of computing capacity and uncover meaningful patterns. A lot of people, when they talk about big data and analytics, they immediately jump to the frame, what is essentially, you know, kind of needle in the haystack metaphor, that what this is about is finding that key fact, that key insight amidst an unmanageable tsunami of other data points. And yes, that's part of it, but that's not the most interesting part of it. The most interesting part of it isn't finding the needle in the haystack. The most interesting part of it is understanding the haystack. It's, another way to put it is, it's not just about finding the answer to the question you knew how to ask going in. It's about finding the answers to questions you didn't know to ask in the first place. And you only get to know to ask them when you can begin to see patterns in what looks like chaos.
Frame the right questions that can make a difference, because that's the value that they